Fleming Cassy, talking about the behavior and the fate of cerium oxide particles in the rats. So please, Fleming.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everybody. Thank you, and hope I can get your attention after, once again, a good lunch. So I'm going to talk today about cerium oxide, work that we've done within the context of the OECD working party on the manufactured nanomaterials. Before we even started this work, we first did a review on cerium oxide, what kind of information was already available in terms of toxicity. And as some of you may know, cerium oxide is now mainly used as a fuel combustion catalyst, whereas it previously was used as a polisher material. But in the end, there is quite limited environmental and health effects in the database. Much is derived from in vitro studies, but there's very limited work on in vivo. So that was one of the key reasons to perform inhalation studies with this kind of material. Our Ministry of Environment was one of the sponsors in the OECD sponsorship program for cerium oxide, and they requested to do 4-week inhalation studies according to a standard OECD protocol, the TT412, for those who are familiar with routine testing. Studies were performed at 3 dose levels, and we had 3 types of cerium oxide commercially available. Of 2 of them were said to be below 100 nanometer, and 1 was below 500 nanometer. The effects were determined after the last exposure day, so that's 20-day exposures, and then also after 40 days of exposure to see if there's any recovery effects. Basically looking at organ pathology, specifically also at lung lavage parameters for oxidative stress, inflammatory potential, and cytotoxicity. And on top of that, which is not part of a TT412, also looking at biodistributions. So if you buy these commercial products from, in this case, you can see the companies on top of this table, they will tell you this is 40 nanometer particles or 5 to 10 nanometer particles. But once you have that material and you aerosolize it again, you will see that the material is in a much larger size range. So we roughly get the same size ranges here, about 1 to 2 or 1 to 1.5 micrometer in aerodynamic particle size. That has to do with the fact that you all have agglomerates rather than having single particles in your atmosphere. So, next. Okay. Now, you can make beautiful pictures out of that. If you just take it out of the bottle, you get the various size and shapes here from Cigna, having quite large particles in there. Some of them are really in the 5 to 10 micrometer, but there are also tiny parts of in there. The Umicore and Antaria that consist of a lot of more smaller particles, nanoparticles, you can see that they form aggregates. But this is when you just get it out of the bottle. If you resuspend in air as an aerosol, these large structures are the fibers on which you collect your particles. You can see that there's, well, more or less the same type of particles also in the same size range. You can take a closer look for that. And this is, for example, a sigma where you have very large particles. You can still not see them by the eye, but they're large compared to the also tiny particles that are present in there, or large particles that absorb the very tiny particles as well. So all kinds of features you can find in these particles. Umicore is much more uniform in its sizes. Still aggregates. Occasionally you see single particles, but there are not that many in terms of number. And Antaria, slightly different in its visual shapes, but more or less the same as the Umicore. Now, the exposure concentrations were fairly high. We exposed them in milligram per cube range, which is well above any limit or any exposure conditions that you probably can find unless you have a catastrophe in your plant where you make these particles. Looking at neutrophils as an indicator for inflammatory responses in the lung, you see that there's a dose-related response for all three types of particles, and not really seeing a difference between any of these in terms of the responses or the potency. But also, after a 40-day recovery period, you still see that the inflammatory is present. So it's not that when you take away the stimulus that your effect is immediately diminished. Now, if you look at more sensitive parameters like total protein as an indicator for toxicity, then Antaria, the one with the smallest particles in there, is slightly more potent than all of the others at the very high dose level. And again, you also see that at recovery. So you may see some differences there appearing, but it's not that striking. So I can go on and on with all these parameters that we measured. We measured also effects in blood, no differences there if you see any effect. Most of the parameters, in fact, were quite negative in this study, and I only took out a couple of them that were positive. So we do see some slight increases in macrophages that were involved in particle clearance, but there were no signs of overload with these high concentrations. Neutrophil influx was present, and also increase in some of the biochemical parameters. The inflammation and cytotoxicity, although at lower levels, was still present after recovery period. So it does tell you that there is some persistent effects there ongoing. And the question is that because the serum is still present, or is there another feature going on there? On the other end, there's no clear pathology seen there. There's no structural changes in the lung or any of the other organs. So the question come up, how does the material distribute along the body? Well, here, this is a comparison with the three particles again, where you see that the sigma, the percentage of deposition in these particles is higher compared to the other two. But overall, there's not much of a difference there. And then that's reflecting also the more or less same aerodynamic diameters that these particles have, irrespective of their primary particle size. The opposite is true if you look at other organs. The interesting thing is already that these particles do translocate. You can find amounts in liver, spleen, kidney, or other organs. In terms of percentage, it's rather low. It's well below 1% of the dose that you can find in the lung. But still, after a single dose, you can see after, so that's basically after 24 hours, you can see that serum oxide can be retrieved in most of the organs in the body. The red. Repeated dose, then you see that you can have an accumulation. So these bars here represent an increasing number of exposure days, with the black ones being 90 exposures in a total of 28 days with 27-hour recovery. So there's a dose, there's an increase in the actual dose delivered to the various organs for the sigma material, but some organs are not that well reached, like the brain. So there is accumulation in organs, and there is also signs of very slow clearance. Umicore behaves differently. You see that, again, there is an accumulation in the lung, but also a clearance appearing to be present already at 72 hours. But the rest of the organs are not well affected by cerium oxide. So there's more accumulation in the lung, but also rapid clearance there. And for Antaria, the very small particles, again, you see that there is accumulation in other organs, but there's much more variability there. And here, I'm not sure if that's really a true effect. The interesting point was that you see some accumulation occurring in the brain after a long time, but I guess that this needs to be checked more thoroughly. So overall, these studies show that there is moderate differences in toxicity despite the large differences in primary particle size. So all the efforts that people undertake to get back to the original particle size of the manufacturer may not be all that relevant in reality if you are exposed to aggregates rather than single primary particles. Yet you see that the very small particles for 5 to 10 aggregates have maybe the highest toxic potency, but certainly not the highest mass that was deposited in the lungs or being the exposure concentration. So there is no clear mass-related effect seen in this in these studies. We do see accumulation of the material, which also points out that long-term low-dose exposure might be a problem if you are exposed to nanomaterials or any other type of particle. So that specifically needs to be addressed more thoroughly in long-term exposure studies. And particularly because you see signs of retention in organs and very slow clearance. So there is no linear relationship between primary particle size or surface on any of the pulmonary deposition. And the key reason for that is that most of the dose is actually determined by the aerodynamic diameter rather than the primary particle size. And in fact, it will be quite impossible from this material, maybe from other material, but most particles, once they aggregate, you don't get them back into their original production size when you aerosolize them. Now, this is an application using just pure cerium oxide, and just to emphasize that it's also of interest to look at the application of cerium. I started this presentation that it's a fuel additive, so it would be more interesting to see what will happen in real life. So one of the studies that we also did is we added cerium oxide to a diesel fuel, combusted fuel in an engine, and then exposed animals for 4 weeks and see what kind of effects we see. Now, one feature, and I don't know if you can see it here clearly, is that this is a soot particle or a soot aggregate. But within the aggregate, you see very tiny 2 to 3 nanometer cerium oxide particles. But they are encapsulated, so it's not quite sure if cells really come into contact with that kind of material. But they are much smaller than any of the particles that we've used in the other studies. Here, in fact, you're looking at the effect of a diesel exhaust. What kind of effects can you see? Well, you don't see a lot in the lung nowadays with diesel exhaust because it's quite clean. But this model was a mice model where aterotic plaques are formed spontaneously, and there was an increase in that plaque size in arteries due to the diesel exposure. But once you've added cerium to the diesel, you see that plaque formation was reduced. So that's a beneficial effect of a nanomaterial added in a fuel. On the other end, when you look at brain responses, here we looked at the effects on cytokines, IL-1 and TNF-alpha, looking at the brain or cerebellum as part of it. Here, again, this diesel is increasing those pro-inflammatory mediators, but cerium is on top of that, getting it maybe the situation worse. But the interpretation of those kinds of effects is rather complicated, I guess. So it highly depends on what kind of organs you're looking at, what kind of features, what kind of endpoints, if you would say it's an adverse or a beneficial effect of using a nanomaterial in your products. So this is just one example, and my message would be, well, it's interesting to look at all these nanoparticles in isolation, but also try to also look at the application, how it's used, and can you come up with a more complicated design studying the material as you are exposed in real life. So if you want to read more of that, we have 3 papers either in publication or already in there. That's all. Thank you.
So thank you, Fleming. You slightly overload your time, so maybe we have time only for one urgent question from the audience, otherwise...
If it's not mass nor the surface, what do you think, what is your hypothesis in terms of surface composition that may lead to these different health effects?
Well, in this case, for the pure cerium studies, I think we saw the differences more in the particle numbers. So maybe it's the particle numbers that drive the effects that we saw with the pure cerium particles, yeah, and not the surface chemistry. Because we know from other studies that if you have primary particles of cerium oxide, they can be quite potent. But in this case, the aggregates, they don't express a lot of chemical activity, so Maybe it's just the number of particles that hit alveoli or so that causes these types of effects.
Okay, so thank you, Fleming.